constitutional law can have a reputation for being dry, boring, and focused on legal minutia, and yet for many nations, a constitution acts as the bedrock on which that nation's laws, rules, and responsibilities are built. The Soviet Union was no different, with its legal and state structures being enshrined in constitutional law. But for the USSR, it wasn't a single document in place for the lifespan of the country. Instead, there were four different constitutions introduced over the 80 years the country existed. I'm your host, David, and today we are going to look at these Soviet constitutions to gain a better understanding of the impact these documents had on Soviet politics and life, with much of our focus on the 1936 and 1977 versions. This is the Cold War. More than once, viewers like you have commented that a new Cold War video dropping on a Saturday is like Saturday morning cartoons when we were kids. And to really capture that vibe, you need the sponsor of today's video, Magic Spoon. Magic Spoon is an eat-anytime cereal that's made with wholesome ingredients, with no sugar, keeps me full all morning, and best of all, tastes delicious. Each serving of Magic Spoon has 140 calories, 0 grams of sugar, 13 to 14 grams of protein, and 4 to 5 net grams of carbs, and it comes in 4 delicious flavors: frosted, fruity, cocoa, and my favorite, peanut butter. Magic Spoon is also great for people who are carb conscious, since it's gluten and grain and soy free. Click the link below to grab a variety pack and try it today. And be sure to use the promo code COLDWAR at checkout to get $5 off any order. Or go to magicspoon.com/coldwar. Magic Spoon is so confident in their product, it's backed with a 100% happiness guarantee. If you don't like it for any reason, they'll refund your money, no questions asked. So click the link below or scan the QR code on the screen and use the code COLDWAR for $5 off, or go to magicspoon.com/coldwar to save $5 today. In 1993, Roderick Braithwaite, the ambassador to the USSR from the Court of St. James, that's the British ambassador, by the way, referred to the USSR as the most democratic government ever created, with extensive freedoms enshrined in its constitution. It was also, as Braithwaite noted, all a fraud. Now, in past episodes, we've talked about the Soviet legal system and the use of law by Soviet leaders to codify and normalize their policies. The Constitution, despite being almost completely ceremonial for most of the USSR's existence, was nevertheless seen by Soviet leaders as an important tool to provide a semblance of legal justification for their rule. On the other hand, though, the constitutions also helped to give citizens an understanding of their place within Soviet society and some expectation of where the limits of their personal freedoms resided, and even an idea of how to address issues with political leaders. Okay, so you've probably already noticed that I keep saying constitutions as a plural rather than as a singular. That's because, as pointed out in the introduction, the USSR actually had 4 constitutions, one written in 1918, one in 1924, one in 1936, the so-called Stalin Constitution, and 1977's Brezhnev Constitution. For this episode, we will largely be focusing on the 1936 and 1977 constitutions and the story of why Soviet leaders felt it necessary to continuously revise the foundation of their legal state. I'm also going to point out here that the constitutions are each too long to go into in detail, with each one being over 100 articles long, but they're all available online and have been translated into numerous languages, so if you want to go read them yourself, well, have at it. Okay, so first of all, a bit of background. Under the Empire, the establishment of a constitution was long seen as an endpoint for Russian reformers, a panacea that would fix the country's inherent backwardness. When the Bolsheviks staged their coup in 1917, they overthrew the Constitution of 1906, which the Russian Tsar had only reluctantly agreed to implement, the result of the 1905 revolution. The Bolsheviks instituted the Constitution of the Russian Soviet Federative Socialist Republic in 1918, following the Declaration of the Rights of the Laboring and Exploited People. The document was notable for its lack of clear detail on the structure of this new socialist state, as well as for its grand pronouncements, the most well-known being Article 18, "He shall not eat who does not work." The Constitution was clearly meant for propaganda rather than a genuine framework on which to build a functional state. After the creation of the USSR following the Union Treaty of 1922, which we may cover in a separate episode depending on how well this episode does, a new constitution was created in 1924 by expanding on the original Union Treaty. This constitution outlined how the USSR was nominally going to be governed and created avenues for states to join or leave the Union, though it didn't elaborate on how either of these actions could actually be taken. Both the 1918 and 1924 constitutions failed to mention the Communist Party at all, and instead outlined a government and nation that was not reflective in reality. In fairly typical Soviet fashion, this inconsistency was reconciled as the constitution being the revolutionary ideal that the country was striving for rather than the current reality. Basically, a nice little way to sidestep any failure to meet the terms of the constitution. In 1935, the Soviet leader, the dictator Joseph Stalin, felt the time was ripe to formalize the economic, social, and political system he had by that time created, and he appointed a commission to write a new constitution. Though the outcome was never in any doubt, the exercise was still important for Stalin's consolidation. It meant providing a new legal framework that offered a degree of predictability to Soviet citizens who had lived through extremely tumultuous and violent socioeconomic changes. The new constitution, among its many clauses, provided a legal basis for the Soviet state that was more grounded in the country as it was rather than what it was supposed to be. It gave a foundation for laws governing the public economy and curtailed some of the Bolsheviks' more radical social ideas, such as the abolition of the family. It also provided certain rights, such as the right to personal cultivation of small plots of land for personal consumption. As the noted expert on Soviet law, Robert Charlotte, put, quote, "The Constitution was a signal that the revolution from above was over and stabilization was the order of the day." Of course, this isn't to say that the Constitution was effective in providing rights and protections to Soviet citizens. Keep in mind, as the Constitution was being adopted on December 5, 1936, the Great Purge of 1936 was also getting underway. Between 1936 and 1938, over a million people would be executed or sent to prison camps, usually without any evidence or adherence to due process, no matter what the Constitution promised. The 1936 Stalin Constitution, as it would come to be known, did undertake three things, however, that would be important later in the Soviet Union's constitutional development. It was the first constitution to mention the Communist Party and its vanguard role in the development of the socialist state. It also reorganized the USSR, abolishing the Transcaucasus Republic and replacing it with a series of successors, including Georgia, Armenia, and Azerbaijan. Additionally, a series of amendments in 1944 gave at least some of the constituent republics, notably the Ukraine SFSR and Belarus SFSR, nominal autonomy in foreign affairs. At the time, it was a ploy to gain additional votes in the new United Nations, but it created a precedent for the new republics to have their own foreign policy, something that late Soviet-era leaders and Boris Yeltsin would go on to exploit. But that's in the future, and for our purposes right now, the 1936 Constitution became the primary legal document of the USSR for the first half of the Cold War, until its replacement by the 1977 Constitution brought in by Leonid Brezhnev. Now, at this point, you might be wondering why the USSR waited until 1977 to change their constitution. And honestly, it's a good question. The process actually began much earlier than that as part of Nikita Khrushchev's process of de-Stalinization. Formal efforts to draft a new constitution began in 1962, but stalled when Khrushchev was ousted from power. But his successor, Leonid Brezhnev, was elected chairman of the Constitutional Commission, so work was not abandoned, just deprioritized. The cautious and pragmatic Brezhnev seemed unwilling to move ahead with sweeping ideological changes until his own position was consolidated. And in the meantime, the 1936 Constitution worked well enough and was relatively easy to amend by means of legislation.
Yet a new constitution was ultimately necessary, as the USSR was by now in direct competition with the US for global primacy. It had to illustrate that its system, despite being founded in revolutionary fervor and consolidated through violent despotism, could achieve the long-promised transformation of becoming a functioning legalistic state. Granted, this legalism was based on a new concept of socialist legality, which sought to advance beyond bourgeois legality. Well, that was the theory, at least. In practice, the 1977 Constitution, like its 1936 predecessor, was a signal to the broader government, party, and citizenry on what the expectation of the regime was, and that expectation was stability and normality. The 1977 Constitution was not a wholly ideological document, but it also wasn't devoid of ideology. Just as it was neither anti-Stalinist or neo-Stalinist, it instead looked to straddle the line between ideology and pragmatic functionality. The Constitution was split into 9 sections, 21 chapters, and 174 articles. Each chapter dealt with a specific aspect of Soviet life, ranging from their role of citizens in the society, to how elections would be held, all the way to foreign policy. As I said before, I won't go into all the chapters and articles in detail, as we have neither the time nor the patience for such an exercise, but I will briefly highlight a few key points. Chapters 1 and 2 outline the USSR's political system and economic system respectively, while chapters 6 and 7 extrapolated on the citizens' duties and rights within the socialist system. So, Chapter 1, Article 1 of the 1977 Constitution defined the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics as, quote, a socialist state of the whole people expressing the will and interests of the workers, peasants, and intelligentsia, the working people of all the nations and nationalities of the country. But perhaps the most significant article of the whole document was Chapter 1, Article 6. Quote, the leading and guiding force of the Soviet society and the nucleus of its political system of all state organizations and public organizations is the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. The CPSU exists for the people and serves the people. The Communist Party, armed with Marxism-Leninism, determines the general perspectives of the development of society and the course of the home and foreign policy of the USSR, directs the great constructive work of the Soviet people. So, you can see that between the two articles, the Constitution declared the USSR to be a cohesive socialist state guided by the Communist Party. Thus, the party's primacy over all things, even the institutions of the state, which, though outlined in some detail, were really just a facade for the party's policies. Chapter 2 of the Constitution outlined the economic system of the USSR, and while Articles 10 and 11 did enshrine collective ownership of public property, Article 13, by contrast, provided citizens the right to personal property, including items of everyday use, personal consumption, and convenience, the implements and other objects of a small holding, a house, and earned savings. The personal property of citizens and the right to inherit it are protected by the state. So, while personal income for profit was banned in the same article, it nevertheless allowed for people to accrue personal goods for their comfort, and perhaps more importantly, pass them on to their children. This was a major reversal from the 1918 and 1924 constitutions, which both sought to abolish any form of inherited wealth. Citizens of the USSR reading between the lines of Chapter 6 and 7 could get a sense of what was expected from them by the state and what they could expect in return. Article 35, for instance, stipulated legal equality between men and women. Article 36 banned discrimination on the biases of race, ethnicity, or linguistics. Now, it's important to note that these statements should not necessarily be taken at face value. Sexism and racism were prevalent in the Soviet Union and would remain issues across its successor states to this day. What's interesting, though, is that when the Constitution was published in 1977, it was during a period when several nations, like South Africa and the United States, were struggling to remove legally enshrined racial discrimination, and in the case of the US, debating enshrining equal rights of men and women. So, to some degree, these clauses were playing to a foreign audience. But they were also practical. The USSR had 15 constituent republics, and the demographic crunch left by both purges and wars left it with a shortage of men to fill old jobs, Thus, the state had to at least be seen trying to include women and ethnic minority groups as part of the greater whole. As a side note here, although the Constitution protected women and ethnic minorities, people outside these specific categories, including homosexuals, not only had no protection, but the Soviet legal code treated them as a problem that needed to be expunged. Now, when looking at Chapter 7, we can see some evidence of the expectations that the state had for its citizens. Article 63 stipulated that military service was an honorable duty of Soviet citizens, ensuring that widespread conscription in times of peace and war was fully codified. Article 62 infamously stated, citizens of the USSR are obliged to safeguard the interests of the Soviet state and to enhance its power and prestige. Defense of the socialist motherland is the sacred duty of every citizen of the USSR. Betrayal of the motherland is the gravest of crimes against the people. What this meant in practice is that any crime considered to be treasonous or against the state's interest could be punished harshly. Indeed, despite the purges and troikas of Stalin's reign being a thing of the past, under Brezhnev, the USSR continued to persecute political dissidents, including executions for treason, both real and perceived. While the right to criminal defense and trial was outlined in Chapter 20, it's important to note that the Constitution did not guarantee a presumption of innocence. Rather, defendants had to prove their innocence against a presumption of guilt, something that was extremely hard to do. Now, the rest of the Constitution is a fascinating, albeit lengthy document, but sadly, we don't have time to go into it in greater detail. What we can see from this overview, however, is that the Soviet Constitution was not a document designed to protect the citizens from the state or to make the state accountable to the law. Rather, it was a document that was meant to justify and codify the far-reaching powers of the state and the party and provide a guide for citizens to understand the state's expectations of them and what they could receive in exchange. Law-abiding Soviet citizens, after all, especially under Brezhnev, generally had enough to eat, a place to live, and a job. The food might not have been varied or even good, and the apartment might have been cramped and cold, and the job tedious and boring, but it was there. Moreover, the USSR, a state created in revolutionary violence, saw its constitution as a way to legitimize itself both domestically and internationally as it continued in its Cold War competition with another revolutionary state which often cited its own constitution as the front of its legitimacy. As we conclude, we'd like to make one more observation. The 1977 Constitution would be the primary instrument of Gorbachev's restructuring, that's perestroika, in 1989, in which he sought to empower the previously hollow state institutions in order to challenge the party. The 1977 Soviet Constitution and its 1978 Russian version would become the legal instruments that would allow the deconstruction of the USSR. Article 72 stipulated, each Union Republic shall retain the right freely to secede from the USSR. And in December 1991, the leaders of Ukraine, Russia, and Belarus cited this and other agreements from the 1922 Union Treaty as the justification for withdrawing from the USSR. So while the Soviet Constitution was meant to be an instrument to consolidate the Soviet Union, in the end, it was the instrument of its own destruction. Yet another fascinating aspect of the period we call the Cold War. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel, have pressed the like button, and have enshrined your right to press the bell button in order to bring stability and growth to the state. A huge thank you to all of our Patreon patrons, and if you aren't already, please consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, please remember that history is shades of gray and rarely black and white.